Hi, I'm Mary Sue Rominger. I'm on the board of directors and a volunteer for the Bateman Horne Center. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Welcome. We will be posting a video of tonight's presentation on the Bateman Horne Center YouTube channel within a few days. So we're really excited tonight. We have two really great speakers. Dr. Lucinda Bateman is the medical director here at the Bateman Horne Center, and Dr. Suzanne Vernon is the Bateman Horne Center research director. Together, they will be telling us about some exciting research that Bateman Horne Center will be involved with. So one of the things that we wanted to start out with tonight is something that collectively the Bateman Horne Center staff and board of directors came up together, and that's the Bateman Horne Center mission statement. And the mission statement is empowering patients, advancing research, and improving clinical care for all those impacted by ME, CFS, and fibromyalgia. So that gets us started, and I will introduce our speaker, or welcome our speaker, Dr. Bateman.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here. It's really fun to reach out beyond. We have a nice little crowd of people here in the room, and we can reach out to those of you who are connecting with us remotely. Let me see if I can figure out how to run this. I thought it was important to start with our mission statement because Bateman Horne Center is a nonprofit center that can utilize a number of resources, and we want to come around to improving the lives of people with these illness complexes through a number of mechanisms. I'm going to spend a little time in the beginning, and then we'll have Suzanne for the latter half of the talk. So our vision, the mission statement is how we're going to operationalize this, but our vision at Bateman Horne Center is we envision a world where patients with ME/CFS and fibromyalgia are readily diagnosed, effectively treated, and widely met with empathy and understanding. Wouldn't that be a great place for us to be? And if we have our way, we're going to move it along as quickly as possible to achieve our vision. So how do we create the world that we all envision for people with ME/CFS and fibro? And I'm purposely, we at Bateman Horne Center purposely encompass these diagnoses because there's so much overlap in the symptoms, in the research, and in the many things that we need to do to make progress. But if we're going to achieve access to skilled clinical care, which is essentially what everyone with these illnesses needs, we can do patient education. And patient education is very, very important because you get empowered and you can fight for yourself and you can learn about your illness. But it's really going to rest on these other two very important pillars. And that is, we absolutely must educate and train clinical providers, as well as advancing research for biomarkers and for treatment, for both diagnosis and treatment trials. The bottom line is, there's no one to include in research if we don't have all of our clinicians trained to recognize and diagnose and treat this illness. And these two things hinge very carefully on each other. And it's very hard to make inroads in either one if we aren't looping everybody into the formula about how to reach our vision. Sorry, I've got a cough drop so that I don't start coughing during my talk. So I want to start by talking a little bit about patient education. What we're doing at Bateman Horne Center right now to try to push out additional patient education. If you see in the top upper left corner of the slide, we get a lot of requests for people to come and be evaluated and seen at Bateman Horne Center in the clinic. But realistically, we only are able to get in about 5% of people who call and want to be seen. That is simply because the demand far outstrips our resources in the clinic. What can one physician do for the other, 95% of people? There's only so much of me that can function during the day. But those people who do come into the medical clinic are we feel get a really good workup, and we feel clear. We know what their diagnosis is, and that's a really good population of patients to engage in research, because if you don't do research on the right people, you can get misleading results. So we're hoping that that's a really important pipeline, but it can't possibly serve the number of people who need help in all these ways. So what are we going to do about those 95% of people? We actually had, I think, 800 people who had called and wanted to be on our list in the last maybe 2 years. So we decided we were going to develop programs for patients who reached out for us, but that we couldn't get into clinic. And so we developed a series of lectures, and we did a first go-round, and now we're in the second go-round. And once a week, we're going to have a lecture here at Bateman Horne Center that people can come and attend as a class and learn about their diagnosis, post-exertional malaise, sleep, pain, cognition, and orthostatic intolerance, so that we can help educate patients about how to recognize their symptoms, what resources might be available, and take that information back to their primary care physicians. Joyce Ferrone, who's a nurse practitioner who's very experienced and has been working in medicine for many, many years in neurology, endocrinology, and also seeing patients with ME, CFS, and fibro, has designed a class called How to Communicate with Your Medical Provider. So you can come and attend that class and learn what the tricks of the trade and how to communicate your symptoms and how to have a good communication with your medical provider, because that is a very big barrier right now that exists. We're also developing a chronic illness counseling resources so that patients can come and be in support groups, in groups that may address behavioral therapy. You know, how do I pace? How do I work on my sleep hygiene? How do I explain this to my family? And, you know, maybe meeting with different kinds of groups. So we're pretty excited about that. And then we're also developing a very interesting, I think it's going to be very, very interesting, and that is patients who want to come and meet with the medical educator can sit down one-on-one and do questionnaires, fill out their medical history, and gather as much information as possible. And we will use trained medical educators. It's going to be Joyce, who's a very gifted and experienced nurse practitioner. And we plan on training 4 or 5 pre-medical students about how to take a history, how to talk to patients. They really love the opportunity to interface with patients. And we'll put together an abbreviated version of all of the important information that we gather in the clinic, but we'll do it in a way that's done with medical educators, and then take that packet to the primary care physician. And I think we might also investigate the possibility of having the pre-med student accompany our students from the class to the visit with their primary care physician and help convey the information, and we'll be sending resources about the diagnosis and the science and everything to these primary care doctors.
Will that be done for fibromyalgia also?
We're not really being discriminating, right? So this is anybody who is feeling like they're not getting their needs met across this illness spectrum. I don't really see these as separate illnesses, but on a spectrum. So patients who meet criteria, fibromyalgia patients who also meet criteria for ME/CFS are very ill. And there are fibro patients who don't meet the severity criteria that ME/CFS requires. So, and I've seen people travel through different phases over the course of their life. So we're looking at them not as the same thing, but not as distinctly different either. And they're mostly description of how people, of the symptoms that people are experiencing and the way it impacts their function. So we're working on expanding these references, and we have some things on our plate that we hope to accomplish in this same setting of classes or resources and support groups or some other way. And that is, we'd really like to include classes that help people understand how they might, you know, maintain some of their fitness or stay moving or develop their muscle tone, and sort of combination between physical therapy and massage therapy and yoga, whatever we can do to help people with those, with guidance in that fits their illness. We'd really like to provide, we'd like to develop resources, particularly local regional resources about who we think are all kinds of providers in the community that are gaining knowledge and understanding of these illnesses, whether they're physicians or physical therapists or specialists or any other kind of care providers that we feel are getting on the bandwagon with us. And we'd like to develop remote access to all of our educational resources at some point. I think as I'm going to speak to you as an internist and someone who's been kind of straddling this field, the gap between this field and academic medicine that has so that has not come through for people with fibromyalgia and ME/CFS for decades. If we want to create to remove that gap, that gulf, we're going to have to do a few things. I mean, we've talked about getting physicians in the field for years and years and years, and that is not happening. We're having a hard time recruiting physicians. You know, there's the barriers, but the barriers are getting smaller. So we need to figure out how we can make the physicians and other medical providers want to know how to become a skilled provider. We've got to create that desire. And I think that's changing. I think because of a number of factors, the research that's being done, the Institute of Medicine criteria, there's starting to be a change of attitude, and we can really feel it here in Utah. We also need clinical training and treatment guidelines that are built on a solid base of scientific evidence. If we don't, it will never get where we need it to go. We must operate within the expectations of academic medicine and science. We got to talk their talk and walk the walk. And we're not going to make progress unless we do. And we have so many more tools to do that. The third thing is we really need to provide physicians tools to have clinical confidence and how to maintain the quality and efficiency in their office and also maintain financial stability. We can't take, you know, these are barriers. It's time consuming, and doctors who slow down lose money, and they get sanctioned, and they might even lose their job or have to go to another place. So it's very important for us to work on these kinds of strategies, and they're all kind of interlinked. So they're not going to have a desire to know about it unless they believe there's a strong science and they believe it can be done. So we're going to weave these into our methods of training providers. And I just wanted to tell you that we're making progress and doing quite a bit already. And in 2017 and early 2018, we have a number of very substantial programs for trying to help providers outside of our circle achieve those goals. And the first is we're preparing a 4-hour continuing medical education class that's going to be held here on December 1st. And our goal is to find as many interested physicians as possible to come attend this class. It's quite difficult to go give a 1-hour lecture and really encompass all the things we have to teach about this whole field.
Do you want to say something about why CMEs are important for physicians or what they are?
So CME, continuing medical education, is ongoing education for physicians. So doctors go to medical school, but how do they keep up? How do they learn new things? And they learn new things, and they're required to have a certain number of continuing medical education credits every year to remain certified or to stay on the hospital staff. So they will, that's a motivator. That's, remember that first one, you know, how can we get them to want to learn? Well, we can make it so that by attending, they can get medical education credit that goes toward their requirements. Is that what you had in mind?
Yeah, and I also think the timing of this CME is incredible because right now with all of the other awareness efforts that are happening, you know, it could just be that there will be many physicians who are very interested in learning about ME/CFS and fibromyalgia.
I think so, and I'll tell you why I know that. And that is I've had the opportunity to do two specialty lectures, and I'm about to do another one at the University of Utah. So I was asked to come up to talk to all the neuroscientists. So this is neurosurgeons, neurologists, and all the staff at the University of Utah, and talk to them about what ME/CFS is and how is it distinguished from, say, the fibromyalgia patients who aren't so functionally limited, and how does that impact, and who are the patients that come across their door. And I can tell you, it was so well received. They said, we know who these patients are, we've just never been able to put a name to it, and this is going to make a big difference. Same with the sleep lab. Met with all the staff at the sleep lab at the university. They were so interested in the science and in the new diagnostic criteria, and we talked about, you know, how that impacts the way they study and treat people who have disturbed sleep. And the lights were just going on. All of them knew who the patients were who, you know, didn't respond to their normal treatments. And I'm about to go talk at the pain clinic. I've had many chances to talk at the pain clinic, but this time they wanted me to come back and talk specifically about treatment tips and the things that we do to help people who have ME/CFS. So that's how I know physicians are interested. So academic physicians now are getting aware that there are new diagnostic criteria and that there's a lot of science supporting this, and they're feeling the need to learn more so they can do their specialty better. The third program we're going to be having coming up very soon, March 2nd and 3rd, is our clinician think tank. And I'm going to talk, I think, more about that. Maybe I didn't talk more about it. So we're bringing clinicians from all over the United States who have a specialty in management and diagnosis of ME/CFS. Specifically, and there's also, they see a lot of fibro patients, but they see the fibro patients who are more ill and meet the ME/CFS criteria. These are people who have been seeing patients and trying treatments for 2 or 3 decades, and most of them are nearing retirement age, and what we want to do is bring them together and see what we can learn. I do have another slide on it in a minute. So our process at Bateman Horne Center, we're not going to wait until we have huge funding or until we can, you know, implement something nationally. Our idea is to develop a pilot on site, whatever it is, if it's a class, if it's a continuing medical education, if whatever it is, then we push that out and test it in our local resources here, Intermountain, the university, and get our message out, and that will be our testing ground for developing broader distribution of our most refined educational resources, and see, you know, if we can be a leader in really moving this forward more quickly. But as you do that, it gets more expensive, and the demand is higher. The demand for the excellence in what you do is going to be much, much higher. So I see the people at these stages as really assisting us in it's kind of assisting us in developing these resources as we exchange with other physicians. So this was the slide about the clinician think tank. And this event aims to tap into the knowledge and clinical experience of select U.S. physicians who have spent years in devoted and direct clinical contact with ME/CFS and fibro patients. And we hope to have 2 important outcomes. Remember, these are the 2 bottom pillars of what's going to have to be present to make progress and provide good care for patients. So we're hoping we can get these clinicians to distill the most important clinical pearls that they have throughout their career that can most efficiently inform science and scientists who design and implement research. We're getting more researchers, but they're not quite sure what are the most important things for them to be doing. And that really needs to come from the patient community and also from the clinicians who have spent a great deal of time face-to-face with patients. And then we also hope to glean best practices from these providers so that we can, and get the advice to inform our provider education for the next generation of providers that are already waiting for this. And we are, it's so important to pass on those years of knowledge and not start from ground zero with new clinical providers. And if we could do, think of, these are sort of major areas. I can't say that I haven't forgotten somebody, but there are major areas of interest in ME/CFS research and clinical. What if all of these areas did that in their region and brought people together, and then we could all come together and share our knowledge and experience? That would take some money, a lot of cooperation, and a lot of coordination to try to make that happen. So we're going to do it here. We're going to start with our most in our surroundings and see if we can both inspire and motivate and maybe help coordinate larger efforts to bring this together. So now I'm going to turn the time over to Dr. Suzanne Vernon to talk to you a little bit more about that research pillar and how we're approaching that and involved at Bateman Horne Center.
Thank you, Dr. B. So we have significant barriers in making progress in the diagnosis and treatment in ME/CFS and fibromyalgia. There are a number of reasons for this lack of progress. I've listed some of the main ones here: lack of research dollars. I mean, of course, that's not unique to us, but it is. It's a real big problem in ME/CFS and fibromyalgia. A shortage of physicians and scientists, like Dr. B just talked about, and no validated biomarkers. Now, I put no validated biomarkers because we all know that there's been quite a bit of research going on for the past 25 or so years. But a lot of the research has been done on small populations of people, and sometimes the research couldn't be validated by another scientist because they didn't have access to those same types of samples that were collected in the first study, or they used maybe a different type of criteria to characterize their patients. So we haven't been able to reproduce the scientific findings and hence validate biomarkers to get them to be useful in diagnosis and treatment. So what's the solution to this? How do we overcome these barriers? This is a diagram that I think it was probably about 10 years or so ago, the director of NIH published a paper in Science Magazine or Nature, and it talked about the Valley of Death. And what this Valley of Death analogy was about was the gap between what happens at the scientific bench and how all of these really cool discoveries that are going on over here in the science world don't necessarily translate to improving clinical care in many diseases, not just ME/CFS and fibromyalgia, but in many diseases. So that's where this Valley of Death. What could we do to bridge this gap, to make these findings over here in the research world impact and improve clinical care? What tools can we provide to the clinicians to, again, improve the lives and clinical care of people with ME/CFS and fibromyalgia? That's what we're doing to advance research. We are operationalizing this bridge, building this bridge to make this happen. How? We are tapping in to this incredible resource that is the Bateman Horne Center, and the patient population that Dr. B and the providers have cared for over the years. And we do that by getting everybody to participate in research. Patients and healthy controls and other types of diseases answer questionnaires, provide samples, we bank them, and then we provide those samples to the best scientists at some of the best institutions around the world. And I'll show you an example of that in the next slide. We also partner with institutions. What we're trying to do here is really tap into our strengths. And then, and our strengths is this right here, the patient populations, and really being able to get over that problem of small studies, varying patient populations. And so this way, we can get our samples to scientists all over the world and partner with them on grants to get the really cool science that they're doing applied to these samples. And finally, we're conducting our own diagnostic research. So I'm going to go over a couple of these.
Suzanne, could you stand a little bit closer to the...
You need to stick with the mic.
I'm a wanderer. Is that better?
Why don't you take it out? You hold it.
Is that better? Okay. Boy, I was even almost screaming. So apologies for this slide, the transfer from my Mac to the PC. That middle green circle says BHC Biomarker Discovery Project. When I joined BHC officially 2 years ago, we started off by saying what we're going to do is we're going to create this project that accelerates the discovery of biomarkers. And we're going to do that by providing well-characterized patient information and their samples to scientists around the world. So that's what our biomarker discovery project is. The blue circles around the outside are institutions, scientists, investigators that we've already done that for. So up in the far side over there is Osaka University in Japan, where we've provided more than 200 blood samples to them for them to do metabolomic analysis. Metabolomics is the study of the various metabolites or the energy molecules that are present in the blood or in the various fluids. So that's what they're doing. We've also provided samples to investigators at the University of Nevada. And this is a very specific family study that focuses on genetics. We've provided samples to the University of Toronto to look at a scientific area called epigenomics. These are the differences that occur above the genome, the chemical modifications to the genome. We've provided a bunch of samples and collaboration to the University of Utah. Dr. Bateman has been working with Kathy and Alan Light for many years, and we have a great collaboration with the U, not only with Kathy and Alan, but a number of other investigators. Last year, we started a collaboration with Dr. Durya Unitmaz at the Jackson Institute of Genomic Medicine, and Dr. Unitmaz actually got funding from the NIH for this particular study. We also work with Columbia University and the virus hunter Ian Lipkin, who has done work on various viruses such as XMRV and looking for other novel pathogens, as well as collaborating with the Chronic Fatigue Initiative, which is a nonprofit foundation that helps support ME/CFS research. We recently, just in the past couple of months, started collaborating with the Stanford Genome Center. That's Ron Davis at the Stanford Genome Center, and provided them with over 300 samples for them to also look at metabolomics. And over the past, 5 years? 5 years working, serving as one of the sites on the multi-site study that the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention is supporting. So in addition to all of these, this is just crazy cool if you ask me. So one person's sample, one person's blood sample, saliva sample, ends up going into all of these research pipelines. So that in and of itself is so exciting, because now my blood sample has metabolomics, genetics, epigenetics,
immune profiling done on it. And we overcome that problem of trying to compare all of these different types of research results on different populations, because now they're all being done on the same population. So it's a really important model for advancing our research on ME/CFS and fibromyalgia. The Bateman Horne Center also serves as a site for many clinical or pharmaceutical trials, both in fibromyalgia, and we have some exciting ME/CFS opportunities on the horizon. All of this is actually funded, all of this that you've seen right here, in addition to, with the exception of this one, has been funded by private donations, foundation grants, and cost recovery. And what I mean by cost recovery is we actually sell the samples, the blood samples, to these scientists. Now you might say, well, what the heck? You're selling my sample to these scientists? In fact, what we're doing is we're saving those scientists a boatload of money, because sample or patient individual participant recruitment and sample collection is the most expensive part of research. We take that on, so instead of it costing a scientist $5,000, let's say, to recruit and collect samples and assay my samples, it now only costs them $50. So you can see that that's a really cool, efficient research model.
And we're being reimbursed for money we already spent,
right,
from donations.
I'm just wondering, among, you know, with all the research that's happening, are any biomarkers standing out yet in terms of looking very promising, or diagnosing the illness?
So I think some of the metabolomics work is looking really promising as far as pointing us in a direction of either metabolites that are implicating specific pathways, so metabolomics is important, and also immune profiling. So there are some immune cells that are looking very promising as being and potentially implicated as kind of culprits in sustaining the disease.
Is that the NK?
So
NK,
some T cells, some, and yes.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right.
And cytokines and
that's right.
You know, the whole environment.
So the immune and metabolomics are looking really important or intriguing.
Right.
But, you know, I think we can't kind of get caught up in maybe a one thing.
Of course not.
And one of the things that we've learned over the past 25, 30 years of studying this is that it's probably not just going to be one thing. It's probably going to be a signal. It might be a combination of biomarkers. And the biomarkers for diagnosis are probably going to be different than the biomarkers for treatment, for example.
Sure.
But there are some very promising leads. So many of you may know that the NIH, and I'm sorry, this is a really busy slide, but I'll walk you through it. The NIH recently made awards for collaborative research centers. There were three awards made. There were 10 applications in total. There were three awards made, and the Bateman Horne Center is actually a partner on two of those three collaborative research centers. This first one is one of the collaborative research centers that was Dr. Durya Unitmaz is the principal investigator on this. He's at Jackson Labs. Okay? And Jackson Lab will be the administrative core. They will oversee how the project is implemented. The Bateman Horne Center is the de facto clinical core of this collaborative research center. So now what we're doing is we're basically putting that model that I showed you in the previous slide in play again for this 5-year research study. This is a 5-year research study that will have a clinical project that really focuses on trying to identify subsets of ME/CFS patients and the biological correlates of those subsets. What are those biomarkers for those subsets? How can we use those biomarkers to diagnose individuals or put them into specific types of intervention trials, for example? And there will also be a research project for this particular CRC, Collaborative Research Center. And this research project will really focus on the mechanisms. So really drilling down into why is this subset the way it is? What's making it do that, be that? And the reason that that's important to understand mechanisms is that that's the way you get at targeting specific types of treatments or interventions. You can develop molecules, you can figure out appropriate types of treatments once you understand the mechanism. So it's a beautiful research study that the Bateman BHC is at the core. One of the important things about this particular study is it is focusing on early onset ME/CFS. And we're defining early onset as people who have been sick for less than 3 years.
At the time of enrollment.
At the time of providing samples. And then those individuals will be studied over the 5-year period. Now, a lot of people were like, well, darn it, I'm not eligible now. Mm-hmm. All of this research is being done on people that have been sick for greater than 3 years. So we're not excluding anyone, but we are specifically focusing on, for this particular project, this early onset. Now, even though this is a 5-year award, it will also provide the findings for us to submit more grant applications so that if we find something interesting in these early onset patients, we can say, how does this apply to someone who's been sick for 5 years or someone who's been sick for 10 years? So it's a really, really sweet starting point. This is a 5-year grant, as I said, and $10 million, about $10 million goes to Jackson, and then we are a sub-award recipient of that. So we will get about $200,000 each year for 5 years in order to make this happen. It sounds like a lot of money. We're very, very grateful for this money, but this is just an incredibly cool project. That, of course, the more resources, the more money we can get, the better, faster it'll be. We are a clinical center on one of the other applications or the other awardees, and that one is from Columbia University with Ian Lipkin as the principal investigator. This particular center is called the Center for Solutions for ME/CFS. And this is just the structure of that whole center. Again, I wanted to show these to you because even though we are each getting, or each of the awards are $10 million awards, they're big, complex projects. Big, complex projects. That all these players, kind of got to get a piece of the pie in order to make it work. So for this particular project, as I said, we are a clinical core, and what we will be responsible for is teaching the other four clinical center, the other four, three sites, clinical sites, how to do a procedure called the NASA-LEAN test, which is an orthostatic stressor. And I'll get into that NASA-LEAN test a little bit later, but the NASA-LEAN test is important because it is a simple procedure that can be done, hopefully, once we validate it, once we adjust it, optimize it, so it can be used by physicians everywhere to do that assessment in the clinic. Okay? And again, I think just to give you a sense of what does all this cost, well, we're getting, I think, about $90,000 over the 5 years to make this part of the research happen. Another really exciting research project that we're doing is working with the University of Utah and the University Population Database. To really, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the UPDB, the University or the Utah Population Database. It's got generations of, how do you call Utahns? Is it? Generations of Utahns in the database. So it's really a very special genetic resource. So studies that try to find founder effects. So is there a genetic component to ME/CFS? Is there a genetic component to fibromyalgia? And what they can do, because they have all of these generations in this database, is trace link individuals that are in the Bateman Horne clinic, so somebody who has been diagnosed here and happens to have relatives in Utah going back many generations. They can trace that back to see whether there is that genetic link in that particular family. That's called the founder effect. And if they do find something like that, that has really important implications for mechanisms of disease, for diagnosis, for pathology, pathophysiology. We are also working with the university and the Center for Clinical Translational Sciences. This CTSA is a very large funded effort, independent of the funding that we have, that the NIH has put in place all of these centers around the country. The University of Utah has one of those. And what they do is they provide a bunch of resources, access to physicians. They coordinate CMEs. They coordinate various types of pharmaceutical trials. So this is a resource that the CTSA, we're working with the CTSA to help us operationalize these projects. These patients, in particular, have to come from somewhere, right? Because we don't have a bunch of early onset patients. So what we're doing is we will work with the CTSA to get the network of physicians in the University of Utah, in Intermountain Health, in other medical networks in Utah to diagnose, understand how to diagnose ME/CFS and refer them to us to participate in this research. So that's how we're working with the CTSA and the U and Intermountain. So Cindy, you touched on this a little bit. You know how we're starting small. Even though these are big circles, this is small. And if it works, when it works, it's going to really have a ripple effect. Because the U and Intermountain Health are, you know, they're not small potatoes when it comes to impacting how we deal with diseases and health.
I want to say also that this process helps us train physicians in making the diagnosis that will in turn improve the healthcare for patients with this illness. So this kind of a program is helping us move toward our mission and vision.
Yep, very much so. This will have incredible reach with education of physicians once it's underway, which is real soon, by the way. This is, currently we don't have direct funding from NIH for this, so this, our effort with the UPDB and the CTSA is all funded by private donations, foundation grants, and again, cost recovery. So one of Cindy's slides talked about, you know, in order to be able to create that desire for physicians to be able to do the diagnosis of ME/CFS and fibromyalgia, we have to provide them with the tools. Okay, and in one of my earlier slides, I talked about us doing our own research. And I should have put this as like tool developing research, but I put it as diagnostic research because that's really what we're focusing on. So as many of you know, the Institute of Medicine came out with some criteria that is used or will be used for the diagnosis of ME/CFS. This is what Cindy will be teaching in the CMEs. How do we diagnose ME/CFS? And so what we're doing here is we're really developing those tools to provide to the physicians so that the diagnosis can be done efficiently and effectively within a, you know, limited time frame and objectively. So with tools to be able to measure, indeed, this is abnormal. Or, yes, your sleep data is wacky and you fit that criteria. So here's just a real quick overview of where we're focusing right now. We're doing the orthostatic stressor, which is also incorporated into both of those grants, as well as we have some pilot funding, and we've just finished up a pilot study looking at the NASA lean test as an orthostatic stressor. And if you want to learn more about this, Pella, the pre-med student, who is now, by the way, in med school, actually gave a webinar on this. So it's posted on our YouTube. But patients come in, they do the lean test, literally lean against the wall like this. Before you lean 10 minutes, you're not supposed to be doing anything except standing here, and it's hard. We've even had some healthy controls fail. But it's such a beautifully simple test that takes 10 minutes, and our preliminary results are showing that there are some blood pressure, some blood flow abnormalities that are coming up that are more common in patients than in our healthy controls. One of the other things that we incorporate, and we've got when the subjects are doing this, you're hooked up with various types of devices. So not only are we taking your blood pressure, but we're taking some heart rate variability, we're taking oxygen saturation, and we also look at your cognitive ability before and after your lean test. So you come in, you sit down, we give you a tablet, and then you take some cognitive tests. They're brain games that test specific areas of cognitive ability that we know can be affected by ME/CFS. Okay, this is called Dana. We're working with a company called Antitronics who developed this Dana platform. So the test is taken before and after the lean. And again, some of our preliminary data is showing that after someone is done leaning and they sit down and they do the brain games again, patients are significantly slower than healthy controls. So now in the process of 15, 20 minutes, we've been able to demonstrate, or we hopefully will be able to demonstrate, orthostatic intolerance and cognitive ability. Two of the five diagnostic criteria for ME/CFS. We're also using devices like the Oura Ring to try to get a handle on sleep, the sleep issues that occur in ME/CFS. This ring will be incorporated into the first study, the Durya Unitmaz, the Jackson Lab study. We'll hopefully get the ring on a couple hundred people, patients and controls. This ring is worn 24/7. It's generating data 24/7. It looks at REM, total sleep, deep sleep, and also incorporates heart rate and daily activity into, it's a phenomenal device. So using this, altogether with a platform called Precisely, we can now understand what's going on in sleep without necessarily having to do a formal polysomnography or a two-night lab. We have days and days and days and nights and nights and nights of sleep data on hundreds of people for a very, very cost-effective rate. So, and then finally, Precisely is a tracking platform that allows patients to participate in research from anywhere, because this data and this data can be synced onto this platform, and then that's your data, and you can share it with us, and you can aggregate it with others. So this is really an exciting way to generate big data that's not restricted to people that can come to the clinic and participate, but people from all over, to create a bunch of data that will hopefully help get us closer to developing those tools that physicians can use to make the diagnosis for ME/CFS. So I hope I've been able to cover some of the ways that BHC is indeed advancing research for ME/CFS and fibromyalgia in a very unique and novel and exciting ways that will, you know, help us achieve our mission. That's mission and vision combined of improving clinical care for all of those impacted with ME/CFS and fibromyalgia. With that, we'd like to thank you for being with us tonight. What a great Q&A crowd.
Yeah, we'll do Q&A.
Yep, and we'll do a Q&A.
So I thought
I have a thank you.
I thought for the Q&A, maybe Suzanne and I can toggle back and forth from the mic and the camera.
You'll need to repeat the question.
Okay. And I also, we'll just take the questions and then we'll decide. So are we going to take any questions in the room?
I'll limit myself. I've got some questions.
Do you want that?
Do we have to walk around this?
It's not going to go that far.
It won't?
No.
Okay.
We'll just repeat
I'll
the question. Well,
oh, repeat the question. That's right. Somebody said that already.
You talked about training physicians on how to diagnose and treat this. My question is, we're fairly new to the area, and I remain as yet undiagnosed. I'm wondering if you've compiled a list of physicians who are already trained or experienced with ME/CFS diagnosis?
So the question is, are we compiling lists of physicians who've been trained? So that's part of our goal very soon. But it's and like was like the thing we're it's right on our plate, but we haven't started to do yet, and it will all come together. But we do hope to provide lists of resources of people that we think are capable of making the diagnosis and participating in care, and that will grow as physicians attend our continuing medical education courses, and as we reach out. Yes.
I noticed you have the word autism up there. Is there a link between autism and MECS, CFS?
Repeat the question.
So there's a, on the precisely slide, this individual said, I noticed that autism and MECFS are listed together. Is there a link between the two? There has been some discussion of that, but the reason that they're listed together on this slide is because precisely is focusing on autism and MECFS as two of their starting projects, not because that they know that they're linked, but because these are two very important topics to start their research on.
I'd also like to know, is there more of a genetic component? Because Dr. Bateman diagnosed me back in 1990 when I was in my 20s, and I've had two autistic kids. This is my youngest, Riley. He is now 20. He's been sick for 3 years and just got a diagnosis last Thursday that it's ME/CFS.
So there is evidence of a genetic component. There's a, you know, a handful of studies that have been done. So it'll be really important for maybe you to try to participate in this UPDB study, right? You'll be getting, once, I think we have the meeting with the U next week, I think. And once that meeting, they approve the study, then we'll be sending out letters to everyone in BHC about whether or not it's okay to allow your records to be shared with the U to participate in this study. So be on the lookout for that.
I'm just going to say, too, that there is an emphasis on family studies in many centers and in many places, not just what we're doing. And what we're hoping in the study that we're talking about right now is to use our existing patients to show where the research needs to go, right? It gives us some clues about where we need, you know, what other studies need to be done to make these links. So you are not alone in what you report. So, but the amount of research we've done so far in the field is helpful enough for us to, I think, make this make the point to scientists and doctors that this is real and important. But we have a long ways to go before we know how to link illnesses and, you know, look at the natural history of the illness. But I think it's a really good start.
And genetic studies, that's why genetic studies are so important, too.
I also feel like it's critical to teach specialists and researchers about ME/CFS, not just primary care doctors. Because what happens when you make that connection is, when you talk to them, is they're the ones that are going to make that link, right? So if you're seeing a neurologist who takes care of a lot of MS patients or a lot of Parkinson's patients, and our patients are similar but don't meet those criteria, and we're going to find it that it's a neuroimmune condition, those are the people who are going to be able to make the most progress in ME/CFS because they're already experienced in those areas. And in every area, they know that they see people that don't fit in another box. And all it's going to take is enough of connecting these specialists and researchers with what our need is, and we're not going to have to start from scratch. I think these connections will be made, but then we're going to have to do the research. But if you can build a case for funding, then we can get funding, then we can do the studies to ask all these different questions. And so one of the reasons we're trying to start with newer onset patients is to have the ability to track patients through the course of their illness, because there's almost no data tracking what happens over the course of time. And the CDC study's doing that a little bit, but again, all of those patients were patients who'd been sick for a long time. We have almost no information about what happens early in this illness, and we miss those important clues, and especially if multiple family members become ill at the same time, in that general time period, they might go on to develop different illnesses, but it was really related, but we'll never connect it unless we look at it in the early onset.
Yeah, good genetic studies have been limited because of the lack of access to families that have the disease within the family to familial ME/CFS. So again, I think this study and participation like yours in research is really, really important and will help us.
And further. How do we get on that list?
You already are on it.
No, she's probably not. So that she was in my primary care practice.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Talk to us after this.
So sorry, Suzanne. Conk. We have to start somewhere. And so we have to start with the known and use it effectively. But then we hope to move on. But one of the reasons I need to train other clinicians is I can't see everybody in the clinic. So we need to get a number of very trusted specialists and primary care doctors who, when they make a diagnosis and refer someone over to research, all we have to do is confirm it to include people in the research. Right now, we don't dare include people in the research until we've done the evaluation ourselves. Because lots of doctors, as you know how to make the diagnosis, or they're confused about what to do. And if they just send us a lot of complicated patients, we won't be, you know, and we include them in research, we could tank the whole program.
We'll be part of the problem.
Well, yep.
Just so you know, he's been to 16 doctors in the last 3 years, and I have told them that I have it. And they have dismissed it, said it's not genetic, it's not contagious, and wouldn't go anywhere with it. So even though I had it, and I knew he was like that, we still haven't got a diagnosis.
Well, that's going to change. So what she's, for those of you who are listening, what she's saying is she has been trying to tell doctors of this connection of her ME/CFS with autism in her son, and they haven't listened. But once they understand what this illness is, it's going to matter to them, and they're going to start to listen, and they're going to start to make the connections. But until they understand the illness, until they're educated, and until they understand the science, they're not going to make those connections. So that's why I'm passionate about physician education, because I don't think we'll get anywhere until we've made some very significant progress in getting primary care specialists and everyone on board with this as an illness and understanding the science.
Let's take a Facebook question. This question is, have they looked into people with ME who overlap with Ehlers-Danlos syndromes, EDS, specifically EDS, HEDS, hypermobility type? And there was a similar question regarding lupus.
So do you want to do a documentation of comorbidities?
So I think that's why the genetic research is so important and why we have to ask the broader question. So one of the things we're hoping to do in our Utah population database study is not only see if relatives and generations have ME/CFS, but see what other illnesses are traveling in that family that might be related or might be the same thing, but called something else. And we're looking at other autoimmune diseases, other neurologic diseases, and we're really going to try to see if we can see those connections. And to do that, you have to be a little bit open-minded about what people have been diagnosed with at different times by different doctors. But I do think that those kind of studies will shed some light on, you know, what are the overlapping illnesses and how do they relate to each other. And there's quite a bit of understanding now about the overlap of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome and those illnesses, particularly in the overlap with orthostatic intolerance syndromes and with fibromyalgia. So that's why I think it's important to look at, don't be too rigid about our case definitions. What we need to do is include people who have this family of illnesses and look at enough people that will see the relationships and the subsets.
If a doctor wanted to attend that December 1st training, the CME training, how
did
they sign up for that?
So we have flyers and postcards that we can send to the clinician if we just get the information. We're hoping to send an invitation to all of the primary care doctors listed on our list. And we would love people to recommend to us who we can invite. And then we'll have the information on our website as well.
You might just kind of repeat the question.
Oh, he's trying to tell me. So the question was, if they have some a name of a doctor that they would like to attend the CME, what should they do? And so we would like to get, I thought you were telling me to get done, get it over with. And like, so I'm like, I'm hurrying. So yes, we really need help in finding interested physicians and getting them right in and getting them trained and doing this multiple times. So we just have the one scheduled, but our intention is not only to hold the CME many times, but to maybe go out and deliver these continuing education lectures, make them available online. You know, do them in outreach, but we're just developing them for right now. And our intention is to develop this group of doctors locally who can be reliable at diagnosing patients and referring them into our research. And we really, really, really need to find those early onset patients.
Any other questions in the room? Yeah.
Ted.
The the whole effort to find robust biomarkers, diagnostic biomarkers, mm-hmm. when we have that, won't that help the genetic relationship
with the family? So the question is, when we have biomarkers, won't that help all these questions? And the answer is yes, yes, yes. And we sometimes get a little too narrow in our thinking about biomarkers, because every step toward objective defining this illness is steps toward biomarkers. And I think we shouldn't wish for just one thing that is perfect. What we should do is pile together all the mounting evidence and do what we can to interpret it and use it and move as quickly as possible forward.
One more?
You can ask another one.
I saw a lecture by Dr. Charles Lapp, and he mentioned using it's called anaerobic threshold, blood pressure therapy of some, interval training, I guess. Very promising, the results that he was talking about. Have you used that in your practice, and are you seeing good results if you have?
So the question is about using the concept of an anaerobic threshold to guide exercise. Is that what
yes.
it would be? And that he'd heard Dr. Lapp talk about that. So I'd like to say that there is some promise in it. The true anaerobic threshold is only evident on cardiopulmonary exercise testing. So you actually measure the time that you reach the anaerobic threshold. And then what has been recommended in those situations is to see what your heart rate is when you're exercising and achieve the anaerobic threshold. And then you can use that as a guide to stay below that heart rate when you're doing your exercise. So it's, and then since not everybody can do cardiopulmonary exercise testing, I think understanding what maybe a target might be, but you could also learn to tell when you should, when you're exercising, right, by careful observation and measure your own heart rate and what kind of a heart rate you should stay below in exercise. But I do think that's very important, because the studies we're looking at on cellular energy production and the metabolism in the cell suggest that maybe, well, and all the other cardiopulmonary exercise studies suggest that people with ME-CFS have a very low anaerobic threshold. So you can't do very much. And it varies from person to person, and it varies in one person at different times. So that's why it's a little bit difficult to give perfect advice. And then the other confounding factor is, if you have orthostatic intolerance, and particularly if you have a rapid heart rate response, you can get tachycardia from standing, and that's not the same thing. So we're talking about exercise-induced heart rate changes, so it gets a little bit complicated.
I routinely surpass what is supposed to be my anaerobic threshold just by standing up.
Right.
So you have a device that you...
I do, yeah.
So he said he routinely surpasses what he would consider his anaerobic threshold heart rate when he stands up. That implies that you have orthostatic intolerance, and that's a different process. So that's why it gets complicated. So what we've been trying to do is take tidbits of research and give people reasonable advice. But we're not really to the place where we have strong evidence and evidence that's been validated and repeated by other researchers to the point that we can recommend strongly exactly what everyone should do. So I'm strongly in favor of individuals doing as much self-monitoring as possible, and then learn as much as you can from what we have, and then apply it to your own situation.
Okay, another question on Facebook. Besides money, what can patients sufferers and sufferers do to help? Money's always good.
We can both answer that.
Besides money.
I can tell you, I want every patient to take on the training of their physicians.
That's a good one.
That is the best way. Your primary care, your specialists, and do everything possible to make sure they become educated about ME/CFS. And we're here to help with that. So while you've been disempowered in the past, we are doing everything possible to empower you with this information and to deliver this message to all of your physicians.
And everyone listening, every patient, can also sign up to receive our newsletter, our information, follow us on Facebook, and take advantage of the opportunities to participate in research, particularly research like this. That can be done remotely from anywhere in the U.S., from anywhere in the world, and by wearing devices like your Fitbit,
yep,
and the Ring. And, you know, you can participate without having to be here. And it doesn't cost anything.
I'm going to just make a point about that. Yeah. I saw a patient in clinic who has a Fitbit. And she pulled all of her sleep data and analyzed and reanalyzed her sleep on different medicines.
Yeah, using this Ring.
Yeah.
Great idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's incredible.
Can you compare the Oura Ring with like a Fitbit? It sounds like there's quite a bit of overlap. And does it do any heart rate monitoring?
Or does it? It does a resting sleep heart rate variability and heart rate during the sleep.
So it's targeted mostly to sleep.
Right? Yep. So and the Ring is more in its commercial sense is really to achieve balance in your activity and your restorative
sleep.
Activities like sleep,
right.
And to guide you so that you're not overdoing one or underdoing the other,
yeah.
Which is a little different than the concept of a Fitbit and most of these exercise measures. So they're all good, they just do slightly different things.
So the Fitbit was actually compared to the Oura Ring in a publication in comparison to formal polysomnography,
yeah.
And the Ring was a little bit better than the Fitbit.
This is the most recent iteration, and it uses heart rate and the accelerometer for sleep analysis.
Yeah. So many of the devices now are providing good data,
yeah,
that when put into the right context on a tracking platform like Precisely, and together with some of the other things that you know are affecting your health and wellness or your disease, like these sleep meds. I mean, it's just fascinating, the information and how empowered you are as an individual to now have that information and be able to do something about it.
My voice is gone. You're
okay.
The Precisely only syncs with the Oura Ring, though. It doesn't sync with the Fitbit?
It does not sync with the Fitbit.
Okay.
And we're working on getting it to be able to sync with the cognitive testing platform, with the Dana platform. So the whole API sharing between the devices and, you know, the Precisely, it gets a little complicated. I think Fitbit was sharing, but then they wanted to charge or something like that. So anyway, right now, Oura and Precisely have an agreement. There's some other devices that Precisely has an agreement with.
There is a question on how much the Ring costs.
You can just look for it online. It's Oura.
Yeah. So it's Oura. If you just Google Oura, you can go and you can look at it. I mean, we got a bunch during the Kickstarter campaign, which was, I think, maybe 2 years ago or so. So mine and Cindy's are cheapies. First version. Now they've got some really sleek, beautiful, upgraded. So anyway, yeah.
Got another Facebook question. Do you have a link like on the website, to a flyer about the CME classes. I'd like to download a flyer and take it to my doctor.
Yes, we do. Home page.
Repeat the question. Oh, you don't have to repeat the question.
We're good, as long as, like,
yep, she's
yeah. Yes.
We're good.
I've been asked to participate in research, but since seeing Dr. Bateman, I've been diagnosed with over 30 other health problems, including four other autoimmune illnesses. And I've always thought, well, how am I going to differentiate and give feedback about these particular things? I can't tell what's making me feel horrible. So should I or shouldn't I participate in research?
You don't have to decide that. You'll be
so the question was, is she's a complex, you're a complex patient. You've got a lot of comorbidities. and so how can I participate in research? Most research has eligibility criteria in which we have to go by. You know, so it's, you can have this, but you can't have this, this, and this. You can be taking this, but you can't take this, this, and this. So, I mean, it's oftentimes as easy, unfortunately, as whether or not you meet the eligibility criteria.
I'd like to say something about, back with my cough drop. This is the difference between research criteria and clinical criteria. So when we are including someone in research, we want to include the cleanest case possible of what we're looking at so that we could ask specific questions. On the other hand, when we have clinical diagnosis, you can't really say that you don't have ME/CFS when you have all these other illnesses. And if we do that, then we're going to miss the opportunity to see how the illness evolves and what the associated illnesses are and their relationship. So I think it's really important to distinguish, and one of the reasons we really need to reach out to physicians with the new Institute of Medicine criteria is it allows physicians to make a diagnosis of ME/CFS in their judgment if it is present in with other illnesses. So if you have ME/CFS in the beginning and then go on to develop additional problems, that's really important. It doesn't mean you don't have ME/CFS. It might be hard to say that now if the other illnesses overlap significantly in their symptoms. And
MS.
Right. So I think that this is why the IOM criteria are important. They allow clinicians to make a diagnosis if they think that there's enough evidence to support it, historically or in any other way. But you need to have all those diagnoses because it might open a door to treatment that you otherwise wouldn't have, you know, if you meet criteria for, we see a lot of our patients meet borderline criteria for MS or for, you know, we look like an autoimmune disease but may not fit neatly into a category, but that's exactly what we need to know. And if we're only seeing the patients who don't meet other criteria and have nothing else going on, it's hard to make those connections. But that's why research has to be kind of exclusive. And some research is going to be more exclusive than others, so it really depends on what the project is.
Okay, last chance for questions. Okay, I guess that's a wrap.
That's a wrap.
Thank you so much. This has been very interesting, enlightening, and lots of appreciation shown on the Facebook viewers. So thank you so much. We really appreciate it.
Yay.
Thank you, guys, and thanks, everybody, for coming.